So let's open our Bible to Revelation chapter 1, and we want to start a verse-by-verse study of the book. We've done our intros, we've looked at who the Apostle John was. Wasn't that interesting last week? Even though I was teaching it, I was interested. I thought it was so cool to see John's relationship to Jesus and the other apostles and all. It was great. So here at the beginning, we start with the prologue to the letter, okay? This is the beginning kind of intro to the letter. And so we're in chapter 1, verse 1. And I would encourage you to bring a notepad. I mean, you can go to the anywhere and you can buy a notepad. You can buy one of those little binders so that you can take notes. We'll have some notes that we're going to be handing out to you, but not for everything. And tonight you're going to have some stuff that I don't have handouts for. We'll have PowerPoints. But you want to write them down. They'll be helpful as we go through this study. And again, this is relaxed, right? This is fun, right? Okay. So the prologue, verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, read with me. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show to his bondservants the things which must soon take place. And he sent and communicated it by his angel to his bondservant John. We'll stop there. So Jesus receives, it says right here, this from the Father. So the Father gives Jesus the revelation. And it's Jesus' revelation in three ways. First of all, Jesus owns it. Father God gave this to Jesus. This revelation is Jesus' property. Secondly, it's about Jesus. And we've talked about before, it's the revelation of who? Jesus Christ. I'm going to say again, it's the book of Revelation, not what? No, it's not plural. There's only one as far as I've read, you know. So the book of Revelation. And this is a revelation of Jesus Christ. So he owns it. It's about him. And thirdly, it shows his work. It shows Jesus' work. What's he going to do in the last days? And what's his work in the church here before the great tribulation begins? The second part of verse 1 says, which God gave to him to show to his bondservants. We've talked about what a bondservant is. It's somebody who serves because they love their master. They could be free, but they choose not to because they're grateful for their master and for his kindness towards them. And so we are the bondservants. John was a bondservant of Jesus. We are the bondservants of Jesus. We could have gone free. We've been set free by Christ, but we're saying, I never want to leave my master's house. And remember what we said about the ceremony of how, you would show that you want to be a bondservant. Remember, anybody go out and have their ear, hole put in their ear? Okay, not at the doorpost? Nobody. Okay. Spiritually. So he says in verse 1 toward the end, he's showing the things which must soon take place. And these are the things we read in this book that haven't happened at the time of the writing of the book or during the church age. So these are the things, he says, which soon must take place. Now, some people stumble there because they said, well, this was written 2,100 years ago. It's not very soon, if you ask me. The idea here is not soon in time, but the idea is soon, once it starts, it's going to happen with great rapidity. Okay, so it's just going to be really fast once it all starts. It's not going to be slow motion. Once the great tribulation begins, it's judgment after judgment after judgment, and all hell breaks out on earth, and it's not in slow motion, all right? And you also have to think about the return of the Lord and all this way, that it's not like we're heading toward the return of Jesus. It's like we're on the edge, okay? And we've been on the edge since at any point God could say, hey, this is a time and the rapture of the church would happen. So we're at the very edge. It's like riding, 3 inches from the edge of the Grand Canyon, falling over the edge. We're just right here going along until the Lord says, hey, it's time. And so he says in the latter part of verse 1, and he sent and communicated it by his, who? Angel to his bondservant, John. So how was the revelation communicated to John? Through an angel. It was communicated by the supervision of an angel. Now, the book of Revelation talks a lot about angels and their ministry. If you look it up in the book, you're going to find reference after reference after reference to angels. Angels are active in our world, though we don't see them. Usually we don't see them. There might be that rare one time in your life where you think someone was an angel, you know, but actually they prefer to work in that invisible realm. We live in more than a three-dimensional world. There's a spiritual dimension, and maybe it has two or three more dimensions, I don't know. But behind all that we see and feel and smell and touch, behind all of that is a spiritual world with invisible entities, invisible to us, beings, both good and evil, mighty angels, different kinds, fallen beings, fallen spirits, demons, Satan himself. And so we can't see this, but we can surely feel it at times, can't we? Have you ever felt oppressed? And it's not, you know, by anybody, but you just feel this oppression come over you. There's this sense of thickness or darkness. I know when I was working on Grace Mill up in Sedona a couple of years ago, had the place, had everything set up, and it looks like NASA when somebody comes in to look. We've got all these screens and got all this stuff, and couldn't do it. Just could not. It was like trying to march through, you know, mud knee deep. And then it dawned on me, there's such spiritual oppression in this place. You know, it's the New Age Center, some vortex. I was in Arizona before they knew there was a vortex, though, in Sedona, okay? I don't know where this junk. And, you know, every place that's a good, beautiful place, you have occultism, witchcraft, and all want to, you know, take over. But there is a real oppression. How many of you have felt, though, a special presence of God at times of need? Let me see. Now, that's invisible as well. And so the Bible teaches that each one of us has an angel. Some call it a guardian angel. And this angel watches over our lives and guides us throughout our lives. And so that angel is always with you. And the scripture says that the angel of God camps around us to protect us and to deliver us. There are angels holding back the wrath of God that this country and the world deserves. The book of Revelation talks about angels who are holding back these winds of God's wrath. There are angels who are protecting us from terrorists. They hold them back. And so these angels are assigned to us. And we're told that they watch the church. And they look at our worship. That always makes me stop and think some about reverence. You know, angels are watching our worship. And it must be awe-inspiring to hear songs that we can sing that they can't sing. They can sing, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty." We're stealing their lyrics, aren't we? That's what they sing in heaven. But we're able to sing "Amazing Grace" and songs like these that angels can't sing because they haven't been saved. They don't have to be saved. They're not the recipients of the precious grace of Christ, but they can look on it. And so, you know, just thinking right now, angels watching us, and what reverence we ought to have, what respect, you know, in how we dress and how we act, and you know, what we do as we gather together in Jesus' name. Verse 2, he sent and communicated this revelation by his angel to his bondservant John, here we go, who, read with me, who testified to the word of God, to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to all that he saw. I don't know how John could describe what he's seen with words from the first century. We have more terms, more words. We've seen things, you know, that might be able to describe what he's seen. At times he passed out because of the glory of what he's seen or the awesomeness of a view of Jesus Christ. But he testified to all the things that he had seen. John knew that he was writing the inspired word of God. And I don't know that, you know, when the Apostle Paul was writing every letter that he wrote from jail, I don't know that he really thought this is going to be in the Bible forever. I'm not sure. But John knew that this is the Word of God. It says he's testified up to the Word of God. He knew, what I have is the Word of God. He calls it the Word of God and refers to it also as a testimony of Jesus. So if you want to kind of see how they're parallel, the Word of God, testimony of Jesus, basically the same thing. So the prologue ends with a triple blessing, which we've talked about like every single week, huh? And so verse 3, let's read it though. Blessed is he who reads, those who hear the words of the prophecy and heed the things which are written in them, for the time is near. Now this blessing doesn't have to do with anything about understanding the book, all right? It doesn't say, blessed are those who understand every detail of the prophecy of this book, does it? So we can all say, whew, say it, whew. You know, because I don't know anybody that understands it all perfectly. So it doesn't say you have to understand what every woe is and every trumpet or bowl judgment is. He says, just blessed are those who what? Read. Blessed are those who listen. Blessed are those who heed. And so there is a unique, particular blessing for the reader. You know, because people don't read the book, they miss out on the blessing. A lot of churches, I was just reading about this and hearing about this lately, how a lot of churches, they're great, they're churches with a lot of stuff going on, but they're not studying the book of Revelation. They don't study prophecy. The people don't know anything about what is to come, because it's considered kind of controversial or not important for where people live every day. I just say, what? First of all, if I'm going through trouble right now, the Bible says knowing that Jesus is returning is a blessed hope. I could use hope. That's pretty pertinent right now. Amen? Then the Apostle John, in his first letter, he says that everyone who has... Well, hold your place. Let's look at it. You're getting me going. But look, it says in 1 John chapter 3, verse 2 and 3. And that's just to the left of where we are. 1 John chapter 3, verse 2. Beloved, now we are children of God. Somebody say hooray. Hooray. I'm not hoping to be a child of God. I'm not earning my way into the family of God. Because we've placed our faith in Jesus, we what? Are children of God. And he goes on to say, and it's not yet appeared what we shall be. It's going to get better than this. When are we going to know what it's going to be like? Well, he says, we know that when he appears, when's that? It's a rapture, right? We shall be like him because we shall see him just as he is. And this is verse 3. Read it with me. And everyone who has this hope fixed on him purifies himself just as he is pure. So tell me, why is looking forward to Jesus' return important just in a believer's life? Tell me why. What does it cause us to do? Yeah, you're right. To purify ourselves, even as Jesus is pure. So as we keep the blessed hope in front of believers, there's a purifying effect to this. So when churches, and I'm not picking in, I don't mean to be, but I'm saying, you know, as a pastor and a teacher, I'm seeing how important this is. It's important for the healthy church to know where we're going. To know that Jesus could return at any moment, to be ready for his, we call it imminent, any moment return. And so that's the benefit of studying prophecy. We know what the Lord is going to do, we understand that it's imminent, and it keeps me walking a pure walk. And so it's very important for a church. And is it controversial? Well, is it controversial to say Jesus is coming back soon? Let's talk about it. And if you want to talk about the whens and whys and hows, you know, that kind of stuff is for some Christians, you know, is debatable. I happen to know what is true, but, you know. But we've got to keep the blessed hope out there. We need to study the book of Revelation. So, okay, it goes, blessing for the reader. So it's important to read it. Blessing for the hearer, secondly. Obviously, this book was, like the other books of the Bible, meant to be read publicly. See, when we go home, we say, did you read your Bible? And we'll say, yeah, I read my Bible. And we usually just read it silently, right? But actually, these letters were meant to be read aloud. And if you ever get an opportunity during time with God to read the portion of the Bible that you're reading out loud, you're going to experience in a whole different way. You're going to hear things. I mean, obviously, you're going to hear things. But you're going to see things and experience the Scripture in a fresh, different way. And the book of Revelation was meant to be read aloud. And so, blessed are those who hear, and then the heeders. Can that be a word? Those who heed the words? So I'm going to say the heeders, okay? The book of Revelation gives blessing for us if we heed the things it tells us to do. And I would say particularly the things that we're told to do are in chapters 2 and 3. Where it talks about the messages to the seven churches. We're going to kind of touch on that a little bit tonight. Now, by the way, this is the first of seven blessings pronounced in the book of Revelation. There are seven blessings given in the book of Revelation. I'm not going to tell you what they all are right now. That would be getting sidetracked. And you know me, I never get sidetracked. So that's the end of the prologue. Next, we have the greeting. Look at verse 4, first part of 4. The greeting, John to the seven churches that are in Asia. Now, the number 7 is used in the book of Revelation extensively and significantly. Guess this. The book of Revelation uses the number 7. This is crazy, 61 times. It's kind of important. Now, what do we know about the number 7? Well, throughout the Bible, 7 is the number of perfection. If God had a jersey, I don't mean to be disrespectful, but what would his number be? 7. It would be 7. Team 7 would win. Room 7 is where he is. 7777777777. That's his number, okay? 7 is the number of completeness. There are 7 colors in a perfect spectrum. There are 7 notes in a scale. There are 7 days in a week. When God was finishing the work of creation, he rested on the 7th day. It was done. It was completely, perfectly done. So throughout the Bible, 7 is God's number of perfection. And there are 7 things revealed in the book of Revelation. This is so cool. There are 7 divisions to the church age. There's 7 churches, and we're going to see this a little bit later. I don't know that I'd take notes on this. But if you want, you know, an A, you are turning in your work at the end of the evening. You knew that, right? There are 7 divisions to the church age. One, each of these churches that the Lord addresses will speak of a time in the church age. There are 7 seals. Remember, Jesus opened 7 seals. There's 7 trumpets. There's 7 persons that are revealed in chapters 12 through 14. There's 7 bowls of God's wrath that are poured out upon the earth in chapters 15 and 16. There's 7 woes that poured out, that come upon the earth. And then in chapter 21 mentions 7 new things. So all these 61 times. But then we have a problem. Who's also in there? 666. We're going to get to that. But there's the satanic trinity, right? And so I'll tell you where the number 6 comes from down the line. Don't let me forget. When we get to, whose number is that? It's Satan's, it's the beast's, right? It's the mark of the beast. Look at verse 4, John to the seven churches that are in Asia. Now, these churches were real individual churches in Asia Minor. So write this down. This is really important. This is now we're building some framework for understanding where we're going. These seven churches were real individual churches. So think of like your community or your state, wherever you live. And think of different towns in your state. And maybe think in a circle of, well, here's a community there. And think of communities that might be, you know, you go in a circle around to them. So there were seven real churches that Jesus is writing to. He's communicating the revelation to them. They were in Asia Minor. The first church was Ephesus, and you'll see this, we'll see this in chapter 2. They're all named, and there's messages. The second church, as you'll see in chapter 2, verse 8, was Smyrna. And the notes are already in your Bible, so you don't have to write them, right? And then the next church is Pergamum in verse 12. Then in verse 18, the church of what? Can you read it? Thyatira, that's the way you say that. And then you have chapter 3, 1, a message to the church of Sardis, that's right. And then we have a message to the church in verse 7 to Philadelphia, the church of Philadelphia. And then finally in chapter 3, verse 14, a message to the church of Laodicea. Now, each of these churches would have a predominant characteristic to them. You can think of churches in the town in which you live. And if you mention that church's name and they're well known, they might be known for this. You mention another church's name, they're known for that. Another one is known for, yeah, that. And that's kind of the way this goes. There are some really great churches and there are some really bad churches and a couple in between. And so the Lord is addressing these churches. So each church is a real church that has individual characteristics to it. And secondly, each of these real churches also are a preview of the future history of the church. So write that down as well. Each of these churches are also a preview of the future history of the church. So when I look at the church of Ephesus, it's going to tell me, what is the church going to be like in church history? There's an Ephesus period in church history. There's a Smyrna period in church history. There is a Pergamum, and you go on throughout the seven churches, and it's amazing how these churches really do mark church history. It's crazy. But you see, not only are they real literal churches with certain characteristics, but they also mark church history and what the church in general will be like during that time in church history. And then thirdly, is it okay if I tell you more before we go to thirdly? Okay, thirdly, stand over here for a minute. But I'm just going to give you a quick preview of what is to come. Like the characteristic of in chapter 2, verse 1 of the church of Ephesus was that the church was backslidden. Okay, so that church, there's a note you can write down if you want. So that church was backslidden. And the characteristic of Ephesus was the Lord's writing and say, hey, where are you? You used to sit on the couch with me. You used to write notes to me. You used to send me flowers. Where's your love? Where's your first love? I don't see that anymore. And so the church is backslidden. And believe it or not, the first part of the church history, the church began to backslide. Then the next church is, he writes to the church of Smyrna. And that was in Smyrna, that town of Smyrna, the believers were being martyred. What does that mean, to be martyred? To be killed for your faith, okay? And so they were being killed for their faith in Jesus. And they were standing strong. But martyrs need to be encouraged, right? And so we can expect that when Jesus writes this personal letter to the church in Smyrna, that they're going to be encouraged. That he's going to send encouragement, and he does. And the second part of church history is the martyr stage. The church went into great persecution. Then the third church that Jesus writes to is the church of Pergamum. And that was the worldly church. It was a church that became infiltrated by the world. And the Lord rebukes that church. And the next period of church history, the third period of church history, is where the world started coming into the church. Roman emperors came in. They became the leaders of the church and all, and it was a mess. Okay? So that's the third stage. Following, just like what that church was. That didn't come out. That's not good English. Don't write that way. But, and then the fourth church was the church in Thyatira. Now, this is bad because this was an apostate church. This church, frankly, just taught false doctrine. It was the fourth church in that circle of churches, and Jesus rebukes that completely. That church is an apostate church. And there's warnings, and there's the threat of judgment to come if they don't turn around. So the next part, after the world gets into the church, in church history, the church became apostate. And all sorts of false doctrines came into the church. And we'll talk about that more, that time of church history, when you get to Thyatira. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4. Now the fifth church is a church of Sardis. Next, going from Thyatira, you go to Sardis, and the Sardis church was dead. It was a dead church. And in church history, after the apostasy came into the church, frankly, is just dead and loses all its influence. Yet after that church, Jesus writes to the church in Philadelphia. What does Philadelphia mean? Anybody know? Yeah, we're Americans and Canadians. And from other places. But brotherly love is what that means. And so the church that was next door to Thyatira, or Sardis, was Philadelphia. And guess what? That church, Jesus commends. There's no correction given to it. In fact, he even promises that church that they will be kept from the hour of tribulation to become upon the whole world, which has got to be the Great Tribulation. That church is going to be protected from it. In fact, there's an open door, and that church is going to be delivered out of the world before that trouble comes. And so there's a faithful church. And so following this time of deadness in church history, God raises up a church that is excited about him, a church that's going out and sharing the gospel. And that period of church history we'll talk about when we get to Philadelphia. But that is wonderful. But at the same time, the next message, the final message, is a church of Laodicea, the final church in the circle. And the problem with the church of Laodicea was that church was lukewarm. And Jesus says, I want to spit you out of my mouth. Lukewarm. Lukewarm water. Ugh. Lukewarm soda. Ugh. And lukewarm food. And Jesus says, I want to spit you out of your mouth. And you need to decide who you are for. You know, are you going to be hot or cold? I wish you were one or the other. I'm giving it away, right? But he says, you've got to decide. So in the last church age, the last part of the church age, there's going to be a Philadelphia church, and there's going to be a Laodicea church. There's going to be a church filled with the Spirit of God that's looking forward to the return of Jesus and preaching the gospel, and there's going to be a church that is just lukewarm. And there's also these lists of churches, not only literal churches, in that circle of churches in Asia Minor, not only church age, but also thirdly, it speaks of the kinds of churches that you'll see today. There are churches that are churches that are backslidden. I mean, they are, one time they were on fire for God, but they've left their first love. But it can be corrected. There are churches today, you can find churches where people are being martyred. And we know of churches, you know, around the world where believers are dying for their faith. Those churches exist today. There are churches where the world has just come into the church. And I think of some of the mainline churches in the United States where the world has just come in. And there's really no difference between what the world teaches and what the church teaches and what the world accepts and what those churches accept. And we'll find churches today that are like Thyatira. They're just apostate, teaching false doctrines. And then there are Sardis kinds of churches. They're just dead. They're dead churches. And then there are churches like the Philadelphian church. I want to go to that church. How about you? The Philadelphian church, where, you know, it's brotherly love. There's a Holy Spirit. There's an outreach with the gospel, and they're looking forward to the Lord's return. And then there are churches today that are just flat out lukewarm, aren't they? You know, just cozy, comfortable, just letting life go by. Give me, you know, don't give me too, I don't want the message to be too hot, but I don't like it to be too cold. Just, you know, don't upset me. And then finally, is this fourth? So let me help. We got to keep reviewing so I can remember things. First of all, they were real historical churches, right? Secondly, they represent what? Church age, church history. Third, they represent types of churches right now, right? And then fourthly, kinds of believers. Kinds of believers. So now we're not pointing the finger at the ancient church or those church histories or, yeah, those churches in town. We're looking at myself. We're looking at ourselves and we're saying, wait, am I backslidden? Have I lost my first love for the Lord? Would I give my life for Jesus? You know, for a lot of us, you know, we just have to say, am I living for Jesus? You know, more than would I die, would I live for Jesus? Am I a worldly Christian? Am I apostate? Am I going after false doctrines? Am I dead, thinking I'm alive, but I'm not? Or am I like Philadelphia? I'm faithful. I love my brothers and sisters. I'm looking forward to the return of the Lord. Or there are Laodicean Christians, Christians that are just lukewarm. And Jesus says, make up your mind what you're going to be. Now, the greeting continues in the name of the triune God in verses 4 and 5. He said, John to the seven churches who are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him, here you go, who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ. Now, here's the Trinity. The message comes from the Father and the Spirit and the Son. Now, does it kind of hit you wrong? What's different about that? The order, right? Because we always say what? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So, I mean, they're not like, I'm in line, please, you know. I'm supposed to be in the middle, excuse me, you know. It's nothing like that, but the reason it's out of order is for a reason. And obviously, it's to communicate some importance in the message. Father, Spirit, Son. The Son is mentioned last because this book is all about him, right? And so the greeting comes from the Father, who is described as him who is, who was, and is to come. How else do you say eternity, eternal? Well, he always was, he is right now, and he's always going to be. That speaks of the eternality of God. And the Holy Spirit is called the seven spirits who are before his throne. And the Son is called Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, verse 5, the firstborn of the dead and the ruler of the kings of the earth. Now let's go back and look at the title for the Holy Spirit. Because you're going to look at that and you'll say, well, I thought the Holy Spirit was one. Why does it call the Holy Spirit the seven spirits of God? Well, throughout the book of Revelation, the Holy Spirit is referred to this way, as the seven spirits who are before God. This title has its origin in the Old Testament. And so it's an allusion to the prophecy in Isaiah 11. So put your little marker here in Revelation, and let's go back to the book of Isaiah. Now, we tricked you. We tricked you. We said this is a study of the book of Revelation. But if you study the book of Revelation, you end up going all over the Bible. So this is really a Bible study. We're going to go all over the place to get our context and history and all. And so in chapter 11, look at verse, 1. We'll start with verse 1. Now, this is a messianic prophecy, a prophecy about the Messiah. And it says, then a shoot will spring from the stem of Jesse. This is from David's family. And a branch from his roots will bear fruit. So there's going to come a time, the prophecy, when it looks like Jesse's lineage is cut off. But olive trees always send up new shoots. You know, it's hard to kill an olive tree. And the Spirit of the Lord, and so this root of Jesse is a name for the Messiah. It's a name for Jesus. And the Spirit of the Lord will rest on him. That's going to rest on the Messiah. The Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and strength, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord. You see that? And so the Messiah is going to have the Spirit of God on him. And looking at Jesus' life, we'll just wait a second. Looking at Jesus' life, you'll see that God's Spirit rested on, what's the baptism all about? The Holy Spirit came upon him, right? In the form of a dove. And it's going to be the Spirit of wisdom. Did Jesus have great wisdom? Oh, yeah, they'd ask him those questions. And, you know, like, oh, we've got him now. And he would just give this answer, and we're all left going, I never would have come up with that one, right? And so there's that Spirit of wisdom, and then there was a Spirit of understanding that came upon the Lord. There was a Spirit of counsel and strength. In fact, he would be called the Wonderful Counselor, right? The Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. So the sevenfold Spirit characteristics of the Spirit of God were upon Jesus. And so let's look at those sevenfold characteristics now based upon Isaiah 11:2. First characteristic is he's the Spirit of the Lord, or he's the Spirit of Yahweh, capital L-O-R-D in your Bible. Who has, in 11:2, has Lord capitalized? Whenever you see L-O-R-D capitalized, it's the sacred name of God, which is the name Yahweh, the sacred name of God. So we know immediately that the Holy Spirit is God, right? He is the Spirit of the Lord. He's not separate. He is the Spirit of the Lord. The second characteristic is he is the Spirit of wisdom. You think about the book of Proverbs, and the Holy Spirit's inspiration there is wisdom is personified. Thirdly, the third characteristic of the Holy Spirit is he's the Spirit of understanding. Fourth characteristic is he's the Spirit of counsel. The fifth characteristic is he is the Spirit of strength. The sixth is he is the Spirit of the knowledge. And seven, the fear of the Lord. Just leave that up for a minute. I want to just suggest something. Every one of these seven characteristics of the Holy Spirit are characteristics of Jesus, aren't they? He is God. He's our wise one. All wisdom. He is wisdom from God. He understands us. Amen. He is our counselor. You can turn to the Lord and he'll give you wisdom if you ask for it. He's our strength, huh? Jesus is the one who knows us and he knows all things. And he is the one who we revere. And he's the one who teaches us reverence for God. Notice that every one of these attributes that Jesus is are the same characteristics the Holy Spirit is. And now think about it. The Holy Spirit lives in us, and he does exactly the same thing that Jesus would do if Jesus were in us. See, Jesus says, I've given you the Holy Spirit, and he will do what I will do. Okay, that's basically what he says. And so the Spirit, Father, Son, they are one. And the Holy Spirit, as he dwells in us, all of these same characteristics are characteristics of the Lord Jesus. So this is the sevenfold ministry of the Holy Spirit. And just to underscore this, the Holy Spirit is not an it. People say sometimes, well, the Holy Spirit, it really blessed me. It's like, it did, huh? I wouldn't say it. I saw it at the door right here. I would say him, or I'd say her, right? So whenever the Bible speaks of the Holy Spirit, it always speaks of him as a person, because he is a person. He is not a force. He is God the Spirit. Though throughout the scripture, we don't hear a lot of teaching about the Holy Spirit as we do God the Father or God the Son, because the Holy Spirit's purpose, his purpose is to shine the spotlight on Jesus, not himself. That's why sometimes when some things that might be a little crazy are attributed to the Holy Spirit, I kind of stand back and scratch my head, because I think, well, could that be the Holy Spirit? Because would the Holy Spirit be drawing attention to himself like that? And sometimes the Holy Spirit is blamed for things that he doesn't have any part in. You know, like some years ago, there was it was called a revival, but people would run around and they would bark at church. There was another one where people were just laughing, and that all was attributed to the Holy Spirit. It's just like, well, I'm just not sure. Well, I am sure. That's not the Holy Spirit, because he wouldn't draw attention to himself that way. Plus, you don't see that modeled anywhere in the scripture, in the book of Acts for sure, which is the history of our church. Look at verse 5 now. And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. Jesus has a threefold title here. First of all, he's called the faithful witness. Then he's called the firstborn of the dead, and thirdly, the ruler of the kings of the earth. He's the faithful witness in that everything Jesus has shown us is truth, and we can believe him. He has come from God. He bears witness of the truth. If you've seen him, you've seen the Father. He's the perfect witness, right? He speaks truth and shows truth concerning the Father. Now, this next point I want to cover before we go, and that is the firstborn from the dead. Some people stumble over this. Does that mean that Jesus has a birthday? And, you know, he started and then ended. There was a time when Jesus wasn't, and so he's the firstborn. This concept of firstborn doesn't mean that. The concept of firstborn means that you are the preeminent one, okay? The firstborn of a family, it was the idea of being over all the others. And so throughout the scripture, this has the idea of you are the preeminent one. And so Jesus, he is the firstborn, the preeminent one of the dead. Of course, we're going to see in a minute, in a while in the book of Revelation, how he holds the keys of death and Hades, you know. So he is the firstborn of the dead. And it also implies the resurrection of the saints. And then verse 5, to him who loves us and released us from our sins by his blood. Oh, there is so much there to study and to look at, and we will do that next week. Can you believe how fast this goes? This is crazy. I just can't believe how fast this is going, because I have a whole bunch of stuff to see about what it means. You know, we're going to go on, gang, okay? And we're going to see more and more and more. And why don't you read ahead? Why don't you read ahead the rest of chapter 1 and be ready next week? And you know what else? Would you do this for me? If you have some questions about chapter 1, I don't want to hear about the bowls of wrath or something like that yet. But if you have some questions about chapter 1, why don't you send them in to us and we'll see. Probably can't cover all questions, but we'll see if we can tie them into the message and those questions might get answered, okay? So don't look for the hardest thing in the world. You know, go Google, hardest question in Revelation 1. Oh, there's 10. But let's see if we can't do that. That'll get us all more involved. And probably if you have that question, probably 5 other people have that question as well. Okay, so we'll get involved that way. So you can send it to calvarypx.com. Is that the best way, somebody? Calvary at calvarypx.com. You can tell I don't email the church much. I'm embarrassed. Let's stand up. I couldn't tell you my phone number either. I never call myself. I want to be a Philadelphian Christian. How about you guys? And let's just really start praying. God, make us a Philadelphia church. That's the kind of church we want to be. And I know the Lord is waiting to see that happen. I mean, he's waiting for people to say, Lord, we want our church to be like this. And do you think he's going, well, I don't know if I really want to answer that one. Of course he does. And so just by studying the book of Revelation, we're not going to just see what God's going to do in the future. We're going to see God presently working and reviving our own lives and our own church or churches, depending wherever you might be. Let's pray. Lord, we are so blessed in your word. And we are claiming the promise, that triple promise. We're hearing, Lord, we're reading, and we're heeding. You've already given us things to do. And so, Lord, we ask that as we walk through the rest of this week, we would be able to think about what we've heard. We thank you for the Holy Spirit and his ministry. And we thank you that he dwells in each one of us. And every one of those characteristics, he is to us. And we want to depend on him more than we ever have before. Thank you, Lord, that we can be your people, that you are our God, and that you love us so much that you would send us this very special revelation. In Jesus' name, amen.